Shalom, family, and happy Passover for anybody that is celebrating the Passover now. If you missed this Passover, there's a second one towards the end of the month. So, you know, it could be an issue with you getting lamb and getting yourself prepared. But, you know, so that's the wonderful thing about our Heavenly Father. He gives us two chances to do Passover. So I hope everybody is doing well. I was looking at the latest headlines. It is so many things going on. And I saw several people sent me DMX. He had a drug overdose and a heart attack. And they said he is in grave condition right now. So, you know, it is just so hard to see so many of our people in such a bad state. You know, it is really hard. I don't know if any of you got over to Brother L's channel. He just put a brand new video out today. I did get an opportunity to watch through it once. I'm going to go back and watch it again sometime this evening. So, you know, wherever you are, I hope you're enjoying your Passover. Again, if you did not get everything in order to do Passover, there's a second Passover at the end of the month, and you can do the Passover and first fruits, wave offering, and unleavened bread for a week. So there's always another chance. That's why I love our Heavenly Father, because he always structures way, you know, a way for us to do something, and we just get it done. Nobody said this walk would be easy, and it's not. You know, I love the message that he had in the brand new video, and it's about a lot of these Hebrews that come onto your channel, and they want to start beefing with other Hebrews, and that's an abomination in the sight of the Most High. And I've had some come over here and try to start with me, and it's happened a couple of times over the years. You know, it's not an ongoing thing, but it certainly has happened where I had to, you know, fight back with some of them. And I really truly believe there's going to be another separation, and this time is going to heavily impact Hebrews, and the unruly ones are going to be weeded out, plain and simple. You know, it must happen. Believe me, as long as we're still in Babylon, there's going to be more separations coming. And some of those separations are going to shock you. They are really, truly going to shock you. And it may even be people in your own family, somebody that you considered a friend, and all of a sudden you're separating. So I always say, I always get my heart prepared for things like that, because there's no way it's not coming. Yeah. Remember, it's a remnant. He is only going to, you know, keep the ones that are talking to him every day and praying and learning, and the ones that are acknowledging what he's doing. And that should be part of your prayer every single day, that you see and recognize his hard work in bringing down this demonic kingdom. You should say that in every prayer. Seriously. That's one thing that we know in this society, they don't recognize. They try to ignore anything that we try to do, or they try to downplay it. So we must give him the highest praise for what he is doing to this society. And the amazing thing is, from March 2020 all the way up until now, this place has never been the same. And I don't know how many of you are reading the headlines. Places are closing down again. They opened just a week ago. They're closing down again. Remember, the variants are far more fast moving than the original virus that we were dealing with in the early part of 2020. And, you know, all this boasting about summer and, oh, and, you know, if you got the shot, you can travel international, you know, you got more freedom than people that didn't get. I don't even care about that. when I read that, I laughed. I said, okay, so what you're really doing is giving them an opportunity to go all over the world and spread everything. So, my feelings ain't hurt at all that they're letting them travel international because they got the shot. So what? So a shot that is only going to last about 6 months. So what? And they still get COVID. So now you're going to spread the stuff worldwide. Stadiums are packed. They are starting there around here. They are talking about opening the stadiums, I think like April 12th. They're going to have a full packed house of people at the sports arena. All they got to do is show up with their mask on and they can all sit on top of each other in those seats and watch the game. You're right, Reginald. This is going to be another red summer. You got that right. You got that right. Mm-hmm. So it is, yeah, this is going to knock people down. But you know what the thing is over in Europe? They're already telling their people this next wave is going to be worse than the first two they went through. They're preparing their people. America's not preparing the people here, which is going to make things far worse. It's going to make things worse. But here in my state, there's places that opened about a week ago and they're closing down already announcing they're closing back down because too many of the employees done got sick. And look, this is just a small dose. I'm sure it is going on all over the country. It couldn't possibly just be here. Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody's not going to get sick, Outlaw, but there are many people that got, immune systems that are not strong. You may just be one of those people that have a strong immune system. There are many in this country that don't, and they don't take good care of themselves. They have poor health. Or they eat a lot of junk food and they just don't take any supplements or anything. There's a lot of people in America, they just want to grab fast food and move on. They do not take care of themselves at all. Look, nobody has gone through more than us. That's why I said, no matter what happens, we are going to survive. We are. We're going to make it. We're going to make it. All right. I'm going to start. Let me go ahead and share my screen. Okay. Okay. Can everybody see my screen? Please give me a one if you can see the screen. Please give me a one if you can see my screen. And again, those of you that just came in, Brother L put a brand new video out this morning. So if you get a chance, go over there and watch it. It's quite good. Okay, great. Let's go ahead and get started. Thank you, everybody. And happy Passover for anybody that just came in.
All praise to the Ancient of Days, all esteem to the Most High Elohim. This is your Brother L. Let's begin at Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 8. There's a law and command in Torah that whenever we look deeper at it, it gives us even more wisdom on how to be righteous in our households, how to be vigilant in our households, how to be powerful in our households. So let's take a look here at the law and command in Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 8. Here's what it says. When thou buildest a new house, then thou shalt make a battlement for thy roof, that thou bring not blood upon thine house, if any man fall from thence. Now we know that every single law and command of Torah is important. We know that the Most High does not give laws commands, statutes, ordinances by happenstance or mistake. We know that. We also know that the law is physical as well as spiritual. So this law here about us having a battlement upon the roof of our house, it's physical, but there's also a spiritual component of how we keep this law spiritually and having a battlement over our houses in the spiritual realm. Let's first deal with the physical. How many of us are keeping this law? I will admit right now that in the place I live, right as I speak, there's no battlement on the roof. So I'm in transgression of this law. Whenever we get the land, we will build the houses and the buildings on the land to have battlements on the roof to keep this law and command of Torah. Now, can somebody not make it to the kingdom because they don't have a battlement on the roof of their house? No. What we need to do is examine how we keep this law spiritually, because most of us are living in homes right now where we don't have a battlement on our roof. And remember, spiritual is more important than physical. It's not that physical doesn't matter, but spiritual is more important. So we need to take a look at this law to see how do we put a spiritual battlement on the roof of our home. First of all, what we need to find out is what is a battlement. Think about a castle. Whenever you see castles, the very top of the castle, there's what is called a battlement, where the soldiers, the warriors would dwell on the top of the roof. And they would dwell on the top of that roof to always watch and make sure that no enemies were approaching the fortress or the castle. So they would be on the roof in the battlement. And the battlement was built in such a way where there was an area where they could shoot their arrows through. There was an area where they could toss cannon fire from the roof, from the battlement. And the battlement was made such where they were defended from the attacks of the enemy. They could be on the offense and send out arrows of fire and send out weapons and bullets from the top of the castle, but it was harder for the enemy to hurl bullets and weaponry up at them when they were in the battlement. And the battlement is also built in such a way where it's hard for somebody to fall off. And that's what this law here is telling us, that that battlement had to be upon the roof, and it served multiple purposes, so that a man could defend his household from enemies, and he'd be able to see those enemies coming from the battlement on the roof. And it was also built because the Most High didn't want anybody falling off that roof of the house and dying in an accident. Here in the West, where many of us are from, you still see that a lot of the homes and buildings in the West do not have battlements. A lot of them are pyramid shaped in most areas. Not everywhere, but in most areas, the houses and the buildings are pyramid and sloped shape at the top. So here in the West, not many of us are keeping that law in command about having the battlement upon the roof. So there's times where people fall down from houses, contractors, whenever they're up working on buildings, because as a whole, we're not keeping this law to build buildings with battlements on the roof. Now, as I stated before, not many of us are keeping this law physically, because not many of us have battlements on a roof in the place where we live at. So for most of us, what we need to focus on how to keep this law spiritually is having a battlement on our homes in the spiritual realm. And the spiritual meaning of having a battlement on our house is similar to the physical meaning of having the battlement on the roof of the house. The physical reason to have a battlement on the roof of the house is number one, so you don't slip and fall. And number two, so that you can defend yourself from enemies. So guess what the same function is of having a battlement over our household spiritually? It is so that we don't slip and fall into error that could be to our injury, harm, or destruction, and to defend ourselves from enemies and to position ourselves for warfare, to defend our household against unclean spirits, demons, and even against people who would try to come in to bring destruction to our household. So that's what we're speaking about today, family, spiritual warfare and what it means for us to build a battlement over our households in the spiritual realm. Now, let's shoot over to Matthew chapter 12, verse 29. We're going to begin to see how to keep this law spiritually of having a battlement over our house, of having a battlement over our house spiritually so that we don't slip and fall into this destruction and so that we would defend ourselves against any unclean spirit, demon, or enemy. Listen to what the Messiah had to say here. Matthew chapter 12, verse 29, it says, or else how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the strong man and then he will spoil his house. So the Messiah here in this parable is telling us that a man must be as a strong man in his house. A man must have a battlement in his house so that no demon or unclean spirit will be able to enter in. Hallelujah. Now let's go to Matthew chapter 24, verse 43. It says, but know this, that if the good men of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Listen to the words that the Messiah is using here. He's saying that the man of the house must be a watcher. He must watch over his household, just like the warrior who dwelt on top of the roof of the battlement watched over the city to make sure that no enemy would come in to invade the city. We as the men of the Most High have to watch over our households. We have to have a spiritual battlement over our house so that we watch. So that we watch that no physical enemy come in and invade and rob and plunder and rape or destroy anybody in our household. We must also be watchmen upon the battlement in our house so that we make sure no demons or spirits enter into our households either. That's what the Messiah is talking about here, about the strong man of the house, the man of the household. And if some of you sisters don't have no man in the house, then you are the battlement in that house to make sure no spirit, unclean spirits enter in and to make sure no physical invaders enter in as well. Hallelujah. This is what it means for us to have a battlement on the roof of our house spiritually, for us to be watchers, to watch over our household in all ways and in all points. Now, let's go to Isaiah chapter 21, verse 5 through 6. I want to lay some more foundation about how we must watch. Because in the ancient times, there was somebody that was called the watcher. And they were usually a warrior who stood on the battlement of the city or the house. And all they did all night was watch. They watched for enemies. They watched for anything that would try to come in and invade. They watched for unclean spirits. They watched for demons and devils. They were watchers. As warriors, they were prepared for war and they watched. And if anything they saw seemed off, they would blow the trumpet or the horn and warn everybody in the city so that everybody could get prepared for war. That was the job of the watcher. And that the watcher dwelt on the battlement of the city. They dwelt on the roof, the battlement, the same battlement that the law and command of Torah is telling us that we must have on our roof. Hallelujah. And they were there, just like the Father commanded in Deuteronomy 22, to make sure that no man fell, that no man slipped. Hallelujah. Think about this spiritually. What does it mean to fall spiritually? What does it mean to slip and for your foot to slide spiritually? I can give you a word, backslide. To backslide means that you're not as faithful and committed and obedient to the Most High as you once were. And the reason people backslide is the same reason that people slip and slide up on the top of a roof that has no battlement. You have not put boundaries. You have not had principles that have kept you on the narrow road. So you become backslidden, just like somebody working on a roof that slides down the roof and falls off the top of the house, because that house does not have a battlement. It does not have something that keeps them in order. It does not have something that keeps them safe and keeps their foot from sliding. So many of us have become backsliders in this walk on the narrow road because we have not had no spiritual battlement. Are you starting to see this? We have not been prepared. We have not been on the offense and defense against the enemy that would try to come in like a flood to destroy us. We have not had no battlement on our spiritual roof. We have not had no battlement on our spiritual roof because we have not been praying. We have not had no battlement on our spiritual roof because we have not been fasting. We don't have no battlement on our spiritual roof because we have not been studying the scripture. We don't have no battlement on our spiritual roof. So therefore, we become backslidden. We slide, and enemies and unclean spirits are able to come into our home and cause havoc and destruction because we have no battlement. We have not been watching. What we've been doing is staying asleep. We've been slumbering, that deep sleep of slumber, of loving the world and the ways of the world, starting to love the pleasure of the world. We have become those who are at ease in Zion. We have become placent and settled on our behind. We have not been proactive about our enduring to the end in this walk of salvation. So the enemy has been able to creep in because we have not established a battlement. We have become lovers of pleasure, lovers of ourselves, procrastinators, haters of our brothers. And what that does is it causes us to dwell in a spiritual house that has no battlement. That's why we backslide. That's why robbers and thieves are able to come in and destroy the children. They're able to come in and destroy our health. They're able to come in and destroy finances. They're able to come in and destroy our peace of mind because we have not had no spiritual battlement set up. Are you starting to see this? That's why it's important for us to watch. What is another meaning of watch? In ancient times, whenever they watched, they would stay up all night. The first watch of the night began at sunset. That was the first watch of the night. The next watch of the night began at midnight. The next watch of the night began at 3 a.m. There were a total of four watches of the night. This is why we read in scripture, whenever the Messiah started walking on water, it said it happened in the fourth watch of the night. The nighttime is broken down into four different segments of watch times. So to watch means that you stay up all the way from sunset to sunrise watching to make sure that everything is in order. This is why the Messiah would often tell the disciples to watch and pray. Now, I'm not saying we have to do this every night because we have to get sleep. We're human. Even the Messiah slept. What I'm saying is that it is important for us to designate times where we watch, where we will stay up from 3 a.m. to sunrise in prayer, where we will stay up from midnight to sunrise in prayer and fasting and studying and burning that midnight oil to seek the Most High. That is how we build a spiritual battlement over our home. Hallelujah. It is very important that we watch because especially we as the men of the Most High, we are the warriors, priests, kings, judges of our household. So we must watch. We must be like that watchman in the ancient times that walked around the battlement of the roof of the city all night long, watching for enemies. And if they saw the enemy come, they would blow the trumpet and they would go to war against that enemy to keep that thief, that robber, that enemy from invading the city. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 21, verse 5 through 6, it says, prepare the table, watch in the watchtower, eat, drink, arise ye princes, and anoint the shield. For thus hath the Most High said unto me, go, set a watchman, let him declare what he seeth. So all throughout the scripture, the Most High commanded our people to watch. Isaiah chapter 21, verse 8, it says, and he cried, a lion, my sovereign, I stand continually upon the watchtower in the daytime, and I am set in my ward whole night. So there the scripture is saying that that warrior, that man, that priest, that king, he was like a lion over his household. The scripture says that Jared rose up as a lion and watched over his household. We must be watchmen of our household. We must build spiritual battlements and be watchmen over our households and defend our households like a lion would defend his pride. Isaiah chapter 62, verse 6 and 7, it says, I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Most High, keep not silence and give him no rest till he establish, until he make Jerusalem a praise in the earth. Now, this is a very powerful verse here in Isaiah 62, 6 and 7. Because the scripture here is telling us that we must be like watchmen and we must pray without ceasing to the Most High to always remind him of the promise that he made to our forefathers. The scripture says, pray so much that you don't give the Most High no peace or rest until he moves on your behalf, until you get that breakthrough, until you get that life-changing event where the Father moves on your behalf. Just like the persistent widow, she kept praying to the Most High over and over and over. Avenge me of my adversary. Avenge me of my adversary. Avenge me of my adversary. And finally, the Most High moved on her behalf because she continually did not keep silent, but she constantly petitioned the throne of the Most High as a watchwoman. That's the same thing we must do. We must be watchmen and pray ceasingly until the Father moves on our behalf. That's what it means to set up a spiritual battlement over your household, that you will pray with persistence over your household until the Father brings a breakthrough for your household, until things transform, things change in your household. Hallelujah. That's what it means to build a spiritual battlement, that you pray with persistence, consistency, dedication, intensity, with the fire and zeal of the Ruach HaKodesh, never stopping until you see the completion and finishing of the work of that which you pray for. Hallelujah. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 12. Set up the standard upon the walls of Babylon. Make the watch strong. Set up the watchmen. Prepare the ambushes. For the Most High have both devised and done that which he spake against the inhabitants of Babylon. So the scripture there is saying the way that we pray against the spirit of Babylon, the way that we make Babylon fall, is to build spiritual battlements for us to constantly watch, pray, and speak curses on Babylon, to pray that Babylon fall. Because here in Jeremiah 51, 12, the Father said, raise up the watchmen who will go to war against Babylon. It is the watchmen of the Most High. It is those who dwell on the spiritual battlements who will cause Babylon to fall. Hallelujah. Are you starting to see this? This is why the law and command tells us to have a battlement over our house. It's deeper than you just having a home and having something on top of the roof of the house so nobody slips and falls off the house. It's a spiritual aspect to that law and command of Torah. We must build a battlement on our households. Our households meaning us, our wives, our children, our congregations, whoever dwells amongst us, amongst the household of faith, we must have a battlement over that house. Our businesses, we must have a battlement over our businesses. It's more than just getting a bulletproof LLC with asset protection and things of that nature. Over your business, you must have a battlement. Some of you have daycare businesses. Some of you have clothing shops. Some of you have e-commerce, work from home businesses. Even your businesses must have a battlement over it to defend you from lawsuits, people that would try to sue you, to defend you from competitors who is trying to outsell you or put you out of business, to defend you against envious people trying to spread slander about your product or your service to keep you from making money. You entrepreneurs out there, you must also have a battlement over your businesses, just like you have a battlement over your household. Hallelujah. Are you starting to see this? Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 7. So thou, son of man, I have set thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, thou shalt hear the word at my mouth and warn them from me. So we in our households, we must constantly have an ear to hear what the Spirit says. We must have a prophetic ear and a prophetic eye and prophesy what thus saith the Most High whenever he speaks to us in that still small voice that leads us into all truth. We must activate the prophetic principle like Ezekiel did, where he was able to see into the future and what was to come. And he was able to warn those amongst Israel what was to come so that they could make decisions and they could be on the winning side of the future instead of the losing side of the future. That's the same thing we need to do in our households. We need to activate the prophetic principle to be able to be visionaries, to be able to be revolutionaries, to be able to see into the future, into that which has not come yet. We must be seers of things to come. Hallelujah. That's how we must be in our household. We must be on the cutting edge of future events. We must be on the cutting edge of hearing from the Most High. We must be able to see it before it comes and then move strategically so that we attain the victory. Hallelujah. That's what it means to have a battlement over your spiritual house, meaning that you operate in the prophetic principle. I'm not talking about a bunch of Negroes making false prophecies and looking at doomsday videos saying something is going to happen on this date. That's not the prophetic principle I'm talking about. I'm talking about those who can move in tune with the Ruach HaKodesh, who are tuned in and tapped into the Spirit of the Most High, and who have access to deep data, deep analytics, and who can see into the unseen, and they know what the Father is going to do before he does it, because the scripture says the Father will do no thing, but he'll first tell his secret to his servants, the prophets. The scripture says it is a glory of a king to seek out a matter, and it is the glory of the Most High to conceal it. So we must be those kings who seek behind the veil to see what is concealed, to unlock the seals of revelation so that we can have complete 360 vision for our families to be effective leaders. That's what it means to have a battlement over your house spiritually, that you as the leader of the household, you can see into events that have not happened. You are a seer, a believer, and a doer. You take action on the intel you receive from the Holy Spirit. You could get a revelation to invest in a certain stock. You can get revelation like Mary and Joseph did, where they knew that it was time to move to Egypt. You can get revelation like Abraham did, where he knew it was time to move. You can get revelation where the Father's telling you, stand still, stay right where you are. Don't move yet until I tell you. But the fact is, you got to be tuned in, tapped in. You got to be in sync. You got to be on that frequency. You got to be on that vibration when the Holy Spirit speaks, so that you can stand as a watchman on the battlement of your spiritual household. Hallelujah. The book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 1, it says, I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower, and will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. Once again, it's saying that we must be watchmen. We must be watchmen. We must be watchwomen. We must be watch children. Man, woman, child, all of us need to be watchers. Hallelujah. And the way we watch is we set up that spiritual battlement upon our house so that we don't backslide, and so that we have a strategic advantage over the enemy, because we can see them before they come, because we are standing our watch on the battlement. Hallelujah. Let's go to the book of Nahum, chapter 2, verse 1. It says, he that dasheth in pieces is come up before thy face. Keep the munition, watch the way, make thy loins strong, fortify thy power mightily. So the scripture there was commanded the men to stand on the battlement of their household and to keep weapons and to keep ammunition. So they had bows and arrows, they had swords, they had those launchers that launch fiery weapons. They had all their munitions and ammunition on the battlement of their house. So they were prepared for war physically, and they were prepared for war spiritually, because they had the laws and commands on the doorpost of their house. Hallelujah. So they were ready for war spiritually and physically. They had the physical weapons on deck, and they had spiritual weapons on deck, ready to pray curses against the witches and warlocks, covered by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. They had a battlement just like the woman, whenever the children of Israel went to go conquer Ai, they went to Rahab the harlot, and she left a red scarlet outside of her window, a red scarlet rope, so that way they knew not to slaughter her and the people in her house. So we, as the people of the Most High spiritually, we must have that same red thread outside of our spiritual house. What is that red thread? The blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony. The scripture says we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So that is an aspect of our ammunition. That is how we keep the battlement on our spiritual house. Hallelujah. Let's go to Luke chapter 21, verse 34 through 36. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unaware. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. So in Luke 21, the Messiah is once again telling us, don't get caught up in Netflix binging, watching the NFL games, watching this and that, not saying it's a sin to do that, not saying it's a sin to drink wine, not saying it's a sin to enjoy those things. But the Messiah is saying, don't get so caught up in it that you are neglecting your duties as the watchman of your house. Don't get so caught up in it to where instead of you following the unction of the Holy Spirit telling you to go pray, that instead you sit there and watch the Falcons game. Instead, you sit there and watch the Lakers game. Instead of you going somewhere and fasting and praying. Instead of you following the leading of the Holy Spirit telling you to fast, you ordering food. You got pizza coming to the house. You got chicken wings and all that coming to the house when the Father has ordered you to pray. That's what you call neglecting your duties as the watchman of the house. You have neglected your duty of standing on the battlement of your house to watch for the enemy because you've got so caught up in loving pleasure and being at ease. Never let that spirit of being at ease take you off point as the watchman of your household, dwelling on the battlement of your roof, being a protector of those who you have been charged to look after. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. After giving us all the arsenal of the weapons of the spirit, listen to what the scripture tells us to do. Ephesians 6, 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit, and doing what? Watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So the scripture in Ephesians 6 tells us about all the armor of the Most High that we must put on: the helmet, the breastplate, the shoes, the sword, all those equippings. But at the end of all that, in verse 18, it tells us after we do all that, we must watch. We must dwell on the battlement of our roof and be ready for battle. We must build that spiritual battlement upon our roof, standing at the ready with all of our armor. Hallelujah. Let's go to Matthew chapter 26, verse 38 through 41. Here's what it says. Then he said unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. This is when the Messiah was in the Garden of Gethsemane before the FBI, CIA, DEA, and all them and the police came to snatch him up, before the state police, the county police. They came deep just to arrest this one man. Before that happened, him and his disciples was in the garden praying together. All right. They wasn't at the club. They wasn't playing NBA 2K. They wasn't beating off the porn. They wasn't getting in Facebook debates. They was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying because the Messiah was about to lose his life. And listen to what the Messiah told them. He told the disciples, watch with me. Stay up. Watch. Be in prayer. Watch. Stay ready. Watch. Listen to this. It says, and he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep and said to Peter, what, could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. So the disciples had fell asleep when the Messiah told them to watch. These dudes was slumbered off on the couch, laying on the bed, drooling, sitting there with the Xbox controller in their hand, fell asleep on the couch playing NBA 2K. I'm just giving examples and analogies and metaphors because some over-spiritual Negro I know will come into the comment section like, hey, Brother L, they didn't have Xbox back in the days of the Messiah. Negro I know, I'm using a metaphor for all you over-righteous, over-holy, over-religious, fault-finding, critical Negroes out there. I'm using an analogy. So the disciples fell asleep at the wheel, right? Just like Kanye, when he fell asleep at the wheel and had that car accident that knocked his jaw out of his mouth. Now he talked too much. So they fell asleep at the wheel, the disciples did. And the Messiah rebuked them for that. And we live in a time right now where a lot of the entertainment, a lot of the food, a lot of these pleasures, it rocks people to sleep. You see? But the Messiah told them, stay woke. Stay up. Watch. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13. Watch ye, stand fast in the faith. Quit you like men, be strong. Now, when it says quit you like men, that doesn't mean quit like a boy. That means don't quit. That's just that old trash English language and mistranslation. So he's saying be strong like a man and watch. Watch over your household. Be that strong man. Be that good man of the house where enemies can't come in and disrupt your household because you are standing on the battlement of the roof. Mark chapter 13, verse 37. And what I say unto you, I say unto all. watch. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 6. Therefore, listen to this. Let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Revelation chapter 16, verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that do what? Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. In other words, the Messiah is saying, don't let the enemy get the drop on you. Don't let them slide on you. Don't be out here backsliding so the enemy can just slide on you. Hallelujah. Are you seeing this? This is why we must build a spiritual battlement on our house. This is what Deuteronomy chapter 28 is telling us. This is what Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 8 is telling us spiritually how to keep this law. When thou buildest a new house, then thou shalt make a battlement for thy roof, that thou bring not blood upon thine house, if any man fall from thence. So I've just told you how to keep this law spiritually. And for those that are able to do it, go ahead. If you can build a battlement on your roof, on your new home, do it. You can keep that law physically as well. I'm not saying it's bad to keep that law physically, but it's more important we focus on how to keep that law about the battlement on the roof, how to keep it spiritually. Now, it's one thing for us to sit here and say we need to be watchmen over our households and we need to have a battlement over our roof. But it's another thing for us to talk about the type of specific enemies that we need to watch out for. So what I'm going to do right now, family, I'm going to take you through a list of some enemies, some demons, some spirits in the spiritual realm who will try to come to invade your house. I'm going to call these spirits by name, and I'm going to talk about their function. And then we're going to talk about how to pray curses against those spirits, how to go to war against those spirits and overcome those spirits. These are the names of the spirits that you and I, as the watchmen of our house, who dwell on the battlement of our roof, that we are at war against. We are at war against the spirit of the corrupter, the disruptor, the assimilator, the interceptor, the viper, the lurker, the spire, and the conspirator. Follow me on this. These are the different types of entities that we are at war with, that the forces of darkness will dispatch against your household to cause the result and the fruit of the Most High to be taken away. Just like the Messiah said in his parable, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. The enemy wants to invade your house. He wants to choke out your fruit. And these are the spirits that he will dispatch. I'm giving you his intel. I'm giving you his playbook. I'm letting you know his right-hand men that are right beside him that he releases against the saints to go to war with them. Let's talk about the corrupter. Hosea chapter 9, verse 7 through 9. This is the spirit of the corrupter. It says, the days of visitation are come. The days of recompense are come. Israel shall know it. The prophet is a fool. The spiritual man is mad. For the multitude of thine iniquity and the great hatred, the watchman of Ephraim was with my Elohim. But the prophet is a snare of a fowler in all his ways, and hatred in the house of his Elohim. Listen to this. They have deeply corrupted themselves. As in the day of Gibeah, therefore he will remember their iniquity. He will visit their sins. So let's talk about the spirit of the corrupter. And in the spirit realm, these unclean spirits and demons, they travel in packs. So the corrupter is the alpha of this pack of spirits. He's the chief. And these are the spirits that he brings with him. Foolishness, madness, hatred. All right? Foolishness, madness, hatred. The spirit of corruption, that's what he brings with him. So whenever you see a lot of Hebrews going back and forth with hatred in their heart towards their brothers and sisters, constantly debating, constantly tearing each other down, that's a sign that the corrupter is working through them. These Negroes, that all they want to do is debate, find fault. All they want to do is bring a spirit of corruption, bring in doctrines that is totally off and off scripture. That is the spirit of the corrupter, and he works through hatred. He also works through foolishness. You see a lot of people that make poor decisions in life. They make foolish decisions in life. That's a spirit of foolishness. And it's also a lack of knowledge. They have not sought out the truth and the knowledge. Our people suffer for a lack of knowledge. So that spirit of foolishness is able to enter in with hatred and corruption because people have not taken the time to educate themselves. They've not taken the time to educate themselves about finances. They've not taken the time to educate themselves about health. They've not taken the time to educate themselves about self-defense. They've not taken the time to educate themselves about being self-sustained. So they become fools and make poor decisions in life, which corrupts them. So hatred, foolishness. Listen to what it says here. Madness. It says the spiritual man is mad. What does madness mean? It means mental illness. It means people being confused. It means people being bipolar. It means people being double-minded. So people have become corrupted because they've ate off all these different tables. They hopping from YouTube video to YouTube video, listening to this elder over here, that elder over there, jumping over here, watching this TV show. So they've been eating off all these different doctrines, and it has made them spiritually bipolar and double-minded to where they all over the place. They don't know what they believe no more, but they will swear to you that they are spiritual. But the scripture here says that the spiritual man is mad, meaning these folks are bipolar. They're mentally ill, and they justify their mental illness behind being spiritual. But it's not them being spiritual. It's them being mentally ill. This is why you see a lot of these Negroes. They claim to be so spiritual, spouting off all these scriptures and stuff. But when you look, their life is in an absolute shambles. They're absolutely insane. They have all these sudden fits of anger. Like they go from being calm, now all of a sudden they're ready to fight everybody. That's the spirit of hatred, foolishness, madness at work within them. And the chief spirit that is working through them is the spirit of the corrupter. They have allowed some of these Hebrew groups, some of these people to corrupt them. You see, listen to this, family. This can save somebody's life. This spirit, this demon called the corrupter, he brings with him hatred, foolishness, madness. You see this? And it says here, it becomes a snare to them. Just like the man who does not have the battlement on his roof, he falls off, his foot slips, he backslides into a snare. People begin to corrupt themselves. They begin to feast off toxic doctrines, and they begin to hang with toxic people. So they become deeply corrupted. As it says here in the scripture, they have deeply corrupted themselves. And what does it mean to corrupt something? It means to make it unclean. This is why demons were called unclean spirits, because in Torah, there were certain things that we did that made us what? Unclean. And when we do things that make us unclean, it invites in unclean spirits. So if we have a household that is unclean, guess what's going to come into the household? Unclean spirits. What type of things cause a household to be unclean? If you allow folks to be bringing unclean foods into your house, if they bring it into your house, pork, ham, all these defiled foods that the Father tells us is unclean, guess what's going to happen? That's going to invite unclean spirits. Unclean foods in your house invite unclean spirits. Guess what else? Unclean sexual activity. If you got folks in a house that are not under a righteous contract of the Most High, if you got folks in the house that are engaging in sexual intercourse with each other and they're not under a righteous covenant, they're fornicating, they're doing unclean sexual acts that the scripture tells them not to partake in, if they're defiling the marriage bed, guess what? They are invited in unclean spirits. The spirit of the corrupter will then begin to come in and work in that household. This is why in a lot of households, you have people getting raped, children being molested, because somehow, some way, the corrupter was able to sneak in there. Somebody was not on the watch. Somebody was not on the battlement, on the tower. So a child ends up getting raped. Somebody ends up getting molested. Unclean sexual activity takes place. And that can happen with the movies people watch, with the porn, with a lot of the unclean things people consume. It gives access to the corrupter to come in, to bring in unclean spirits. You see? And because the people have not built a battlement on the roof of that house, the corrupter is able to come in to cause them to be deeply corrupted. So we must make sure that our households do not have any unclean thing in it. We must make sure that our hearts do not have any uncleanness in it. Like David would pray, Father, purify me, purge me with hyssop, purge me of all my uncleanness. So we must pray against the spirit of the corrupter, who brings with him hatred, foolishness, madness. Hallelujah. So you, as the watchman of the house, as the watchwoman of the house, you must stand on your spiritual battlement and pray curses against the corrupter, who brings with him hatred, foolishness, and madness. That's the first spirit that we, as the watchmen who stand on the battlement of our spiritual house, must watch against. We also must be on the watch against another spirit called the disruptor. The disruptor. Even in the entrepreneurship world, they use this term for a company or an entity that disrupts a certain industry, like Uber, Lyft. All these companies became disruptors to the taxi cab industry. So imagine those who have been taxi drivers, that has hurt their pockets with the advent of Uber and the advent of Lyft. I'm just giving you that example, but let's look at that spiritually. What are some of the things that are disruptors among us? Think about the people who come into congregations and cause disruptions and disunity with their debate, with their slander, with their murmuring. Think about the children of Israel coming out of Mizraim, how there were murmurers amongst them, and they were there to be disruptors, to disrupt the unity. You have people that will try to befriend you, come all over to your house, be all cool with you, but the enemy has them there as a disruptor to bring beef and drama between you and your wife, to bring beef and drama between you and your children. So us, as the watchmen of our house, we must always be on the battlement to make sure that no disruptors come in. What does the scripture say? Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 18, it says, wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroyeth much good. You see, all it takes is one disruptor, one rebellious teenager, one rebellious child, one rebellious husband, one rebellious wife. All it takes is one person to cause disruption in that household. And the scripture says in these last days that a man's enemies would be they of his own household. And you know why? Because people are not going to be watching on the battlement of their roof, and they will allow disruptors into the household. So whenever you see a spirit of disruption beginning to work in your family, whoever that person is that spirit of a disruptor is working through, you need to pull them to the side, apply the holy oil of the Most High, pray against that spirit of the disruptor. Hallelujah. That spirit would be chased out of your home. And even before you approach the person, you need to search your own heart to make sure it's not you that is the one being the disruptor in your household. You need to also, before you approach any person, you need to pray in the house, walk around the whole house, apply oil, pray in the name of the Messiah, ask for the Father to release angels as a battlement to your home, ask the Father to equip you to be the watchman, to stand on the battlement of your house, rise up early in the morning while everybody else sleeps. Pray over the whole family. Pray over the whole household. You can walk around outside your house in the grass. Walk around the perimeter of your house, just like the children of Israel walked around the walls of Jericho. Stand outside in your yard. Pray outside in the yard. Go into the garage, pray. Go into every room and pray, and declare that the disruptor will not have no access to your household. That's what it means to stand on the battlement of your roof. Because all the enemy needs is one disruptor inside your house to bring unrighteous division. You see? And this applies for men or women. But listen to what it says in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 1. It says, every wise woman buildeth her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. This applies to men and women, where you can have a husband or a wife in the house that instead of building up the house, they're tearing down the house. They tear down the house by talking down to the wife, by talking down to their husband, by talking down to the children. That's being a disruptor in your household, because you're not uplifting your spouse. You're talking them down. That's being a disruptor. You're not uplifting your children. You're talking them down. That's being a disruptor. That's the spirit of the disruptor that creeps in to make us tear each other down with our words. You ain't this. You ain't that. You don't do this. You don't do that. You can't do this. You can't do that. I hate you. I hate you. Get out my face. Get out my face. All that is the spirit of the disruptor trying to disrupt the household. You see that? These are real live entities and spirits that we must war against, brothers and sisters. And we must have a battlement upon our spiritual roof to war against these spirits, to watch and see them coming, and to make sure that they're not able to strategically overthrow us in our own house. You would not let nobody physically come in your house, beat you down in front of your spouse, take your stuff, piss on you, spit on you, then kick you out your house and them say, this is my house now. You wouldn't let nobody physically do that. So you should not let no demons do that either. You should not let no disruptor spirits or the people that they're working through do that either. Sometimes it may come to the point where you got to put somebody out your house, or you have to separate yourself from that house because the spirit of the disruptor being there. But first, you must do all in your part to cast that thing out or not allow it to come in the first place. You see? Now, let's go to the next spirit, the assimilator. The assimilator. This type of spirit works in households to make people be under a false spirit of compromise. You see, there's righteous compromise and then there's wicked compromise. Wicked compromise is where in a household you got folks believing different things and one person will compromise themselves and become lukewarm just to make the other person feel better. That's wicked compromise. If you got to start eating pork to make somebody feel comfortable, that's the spirit of the assimilator, making you feel like you have to do wickedness just to make somebody else feel comfortable. That's the spirit of the assimilator, trying to make you assimilate. If you got to put up a Christmas tree just to make somebody else in the house feel comfortable, you have been assimilated. That's wicked compromise. You see? Are you starting to see this? Do not let the spirit of the assimilator come into your house and have you under false compromises to where you're compromising your obedience to the Most High to make somebody else feel comfortable. Now, if the compromise does not involve you going against the Most High, then that's fine. All right. Like if it comes to a thing where, let's say, somebody has to get up early in the morning to go to work and they don't want you playing music in there to wake them up before the time, where you can say, okay, babe, I'll do my music and my prayer time later so I don't disrupt, so I don't, you know, mess you up because you got to get up early to go to work. Those are little compromises here and there. Little compromises like you pay rent this month, I pay rent the next month. Those are compromises that you can do because that has nothing to do with the law of the Most High. You see? But when it comes to other things where you start breaking the law of the Most High just to assimilate and make somebody else feel comfortable, that's the spirit of the assimilator right there. Now, let's go to the book of Jasher, chapter 85, verse 54 through 62, and let's look at an example of how the enemy caused our people to assimilate and take on ways that were wicked. It says, and the children of Moab were afraid of the children of Israel. And the children of Moab took all their daughters and their wives of beautiful aspect and comely appearance and dressed them in gold and silver in costly garments. And the children of Moab seated those women at the door of their tents in order that the children of Israel might see them and turn to them and not fight against Moab. And all the children of Moab did this thing to the children of Israel. And every man placed his wife and daughter at the door of his tent. And all the children of Israel saw the act of the children of Moab, and the children of Israel turned to the daughters of Moab and coveted them, and they went to them. And it came to pass that when a Hebrew came to the door of the tent of Moab and saw a daughter of Moab and desired her in his heart and spoke with her at the door of the tent, that which he desired while they were speaking together, the men of the tent would come out and speak to the Hebrew and say, surely you know that we are brethren. We are all the descendants of Lot and the descendants of Abraham, his brother. Wherefore then will you not remain with us? And wherefore will you not eat our bread and our sacrifice? And when the children of Moab had thus overwhelmed him with their speeches and enticed him by their flattering words, they seated him in the tent and cooked and sacrificed for him. And he ate of their sacrifice and of their bread. They then gave him wine and he drank and became intoxicated. And they placed before him a beautiful damsel and he did with her as he liked. For he knew not what he was doing, as he had drunk plentifully of wine. Thus did the children of Moab to Israel in that place in the plain of Shittim. And the anger of the Most High was kindled against Israel on account of this matter. And he sent a pestilence among them, and there died of the Israelites 24,000 men. So because the Israelites assimilated with the Midianites and the Moabites, what ended up happening was death. They were not standing on their spiritual battlement. So modern day, what would an example of that be? Let's say your daughter, your son, try to bring a heathen back to your house, right? Talking about, mom, dad, this is the heathen that I'm dating and dealing with. Guess what? You ain't going to be bringing them up in this house. You're not going to be bringing no heathen up in here talking about I'm dating this heathen. This is my boyfriend. This is my girlfriend, bringing a Gentile in the house. They not coming up in here. All right. Hallelujah. Period. Point blank. If you in a situation, let's say your spouse, they not of the walk of the Most High, you can't assimilate if they be like, babe, I'm still into this Egyptology, so I'm going to hang up this Ankh on the wall, and I'm going to put up this picture of Anubis and all these Egyptian gods, because I'm not ready to come over to that Israelite thing. So you can't, if you want me to pray with you to the Most High Israel, then you need to come pray with me to Anubis and all these other Egyptian gods. Guess what you're going to have to tell her? Hell to the no. I'm not assimilating into those Egyptian gods. And you got to get them idols up out this house, or you got to get up out this house. Period, point blank. Because that spirit of the assimilator will try to come in to make you assimilate into the ways of wickedness. And that's what makes you lukewarm. When you start doing these little compromises going against the Most High, you got to put your foot down and not allow the assimilator to come in, either through the interracial agenda or through worshiping other gods and having other little idols set up in the house just because you don't want to cause no waves with somebody else. No, them idols cannot be in this house. You got to get Maat, Anubis, you got to get all that mess up out this house, or you got to get up out this house. You see? We don't got time to be playing games with the assimilator. It is a spirit that wants you to assimilate and water you down and make you lukewarm and make you be comfortable with the enemy. Make you kiss up and hug up on the enemy. You can't allow that assimilation to come into your house. Folks talking about we come into your house for Thanksgiving. No, you're not. Ain't none of that Thanksgiving getting assimilated up into this house. We do Passover, we do Day of Atonement, we do Feast of Tabernacles. That's what we do up in here. Ain't no Halloween or none of that mess gonna be done in this house because we don't assimilate. No assimilation, no wicked compromise. You see that? But that assimilator spirit will try to come into your house to make you water down your belief and make compromises with your faith. Now, in this house, we keep the Sabbath. If you want to be working on the Sabbath, you don't need to be up in here. Ain't nobody going to be working on the Sabbath in this household. I'm not going to assimilate. You see? Hallelujah. Let's go to the next spirit, the interceptor. There is a wicked spirit called the interceptor. And what that spirit wants to do is intercept your prayers so that they don't go to the Most High. Hallelujah. There's a scripture that talks about whenever a man is not dealing correctly with his wife, that the Most High will not hear his prayer. So you brothers out there, we need to make sure that we are dealing righteously with our wives. Be cautious how you speak to her, and wives, the husband as well. Because you wives, if you are being disobedient and unsubmissive to your husband, the Father's not going to hear your prayer. You see, the Messiah is not going to receive the prayer of a wicked woman who is not in righteous and holy submission to her husband. Likewise, husbands, the Father is not going to hear you if you're not treating your wife how the Messiah treats us. If you're not dealing with her in righteousness, not saying that you need to be a victim of any of her manipulation or any of that, not saying you need to be a simp or a beta male, but you must not deal wickedly with her as the weaker vessel, because the Father will not hear your prayers. Your prayers will be hindered if you do not deal with her righteously. If you provoke your children unrighteously, the Father won't hear your prayers. Listen to this very carefully. This is important because the scripture also says, fathers, do not provoke your children unto wrath. So if we are dealing unrighteously with our wife, our husband, our children, it will cause our prayers to be intercepted. The scripture says the Most High does not hear the prayers of those who forsake the law. So if we are forsaking the laws and Torah in our household, guess what? The interceptor will intercept our prayers. He will intercept our blessings. There could be some money that was supposed to come to you. There could be a breakthrough in your health you were supposed to get. There could be all kinds of things the Father had for you, but the interceptor spirit will intercept it. Just like in football where they get an interception. You trying to throw a touchdown and they intercept it. That's what those spirits do. They intercept your blessings. They intercept the things the Father was going to send to you. But because there's something going on that you haven't dealt with in righteousness, it causes your blessing to get intercepted. You see? The scriptures touch on this. Let's look in Daniel chapter 10, verse 9 through 13. And here's another thing. Even if you are living in obedience and righteousness to the Father, these interceptor spirits will still try to operate, just like they did with Daniel. Check this out. Daniel chapter 10, verse 9 through 13, it says, yet heard I the voice of his words, and then I heard the voice of his words. I was in a deep sleep on my face, and my face toward the ground. And behold, a hand touched me, which set me upon my knees and upon the palms of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. Stop. First thing we need to look at is that Daniel had fell on his face and was asleep. But the scripture tells us that we need to be awake and watchful and sober. So the first thing the angel did was wake Daniel up and stand him on his feet. That's what the Spirit of the Most High is doing to us who have been asleep, waking us up to stand us on our feet so that we can set up that battlement on the roof. Listen to this. It says, and when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then he said unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy Elohim, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Stop. This was at a time where Daniel was praying for 21 days. And at the beginning of his prayer, he cried out to the Most High. And the angel told him that your prayers were heard on the first day of your fast and the first day of your prayer. But the reason I was not able to get to you quicker is because there was an interceptor spirit. There was a prince of Persia who withstood me. So family, whenever we pray for certain breakthroughs, whenever we pray for things, the enemy dispatches interceptor spirits that will try to block what we prayed for from manifesting. So guess what we got to do? We got to pray against those interceptor spirits. And I'm going to tell you what the names of those spirits are because it is revealed in the book of 3rd Enoch. Let's go to 3rd Enoch real quick, and we're going to see the names of these interceptor spirits. We already got a hint in Daniel chapter 10 because the scripture said it was the prince of the kingdom of Persia who was one of the interceptors, but there's two others. Let's go to 3rd Enoch and see what those two other spirits are who intercept the prayers of the saints and intercept the blessings of the saints. It says, 3rd Enoch, why are they called seraphim? Because they burn seraph, the writing tables of Satan. Every day Satan is sitting together with Samael, the prince of Rome, and with Dubiel, the prince of Persia. Stop, stop, stop. So these interceptor spirits are Samael and Dubiel. That is their names, Samael and Dubiel. And it says Samael, he is the prince of Rome. Think the Vatican. Think that area up there. Think the area of Turkey where Emperor Constantine reigned at. The Pope, Emperor Constantine, all of them were under the influence of the spirit of Samael. He is an interceptor spirit. And he's still at work today. Listen to this. And with Dubiel, the prince of Persia. So Dubiel is the other interceptor spirit. He is over Persia. That is the realm where Islam is real heavy at. So Catholicism, Islam, Samael and Dubiel, Rome and Persia, Rome and Babylon. These are the interceptor spirits that whenever those of us who are on the true narrow road of the Father, whenever we pray, these spirits of Samael and Dubiel, they try to intercept the righteous prayers of the saints. You see that? That's what they're doing all day long at the Vatican, is they're sending up curses to try to intercept the prayers of the real saints. That's why those in Islam, that's why they do their prayers 5 times a day, because they're releasing those interceptor spirits. As hard as you go in to try to pray to the Most High, they're praying to Satan to block your prayers to the Most High. And they're sending out these interceptor spirits. That's why we must establish ourselves on the battlement to pray against these interceptor spirits. Even if you got to pray for 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, 24 hours to break the power of those interceptor spirits, you need to do it. But let's read this again. Third Enoch. Why are they called seraphim? Because they burn seraph, the writing tables of Satan. Every day, Satan is sitting together with Samael, the prince of Rome, and with Dubiel, the prince of Persia. And they write the iniquities of Israel on writing tables, which they hand over to the seraphim in order that they may present them before the Holy One, so that he may destroy Israel from the world. But the seraphim know that the Most High desires not that his people Israel should perish. And every day they receive from the hand of Satan and burn them in the burning fire over against the high exalted throne. So these interceptor spirits, they act as accusers of the saints. And they try to remind the Most High of our sins to make the Most High turn against us. Similar to how Satan tried to go at Job. Satan accused Job before the throne of the Most High. And that's what these interceptor spirits do every day. They try to accuse us and say, brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so doing this, Most High. They don't deserve this blessing that you're trying to send them, because look what they're doing over here. And that is why we must walk blameless in the ways of the Most High, so that these interceptor spirits will not have nothing to point to try to persuade the Most High to not release to us our blessings that we're worthy of. You see? This is deep, y'all. It goes deep. That's why the Father tells us to walk blameless, so that these interceptor spirits will have nothing to accuse us about. Hallelujah. So we need to pray against those interceptor spirits. Let's go to the next spirit, the viper. The viper. In scripture, you always hear the Messiah talk about, you generation of vipers. John the Baptist, you generation of vipers. Why do you think he kept saying that? It's because there is a demonic entity. There is a spirit that's called the viper that seeks to strike and inflict poison on the saints. And what does that viper come through? Offense. Many people have offenses. They are offended at other brothers and sisters. Somebody said something to them. Somebody did something to them. And they have not got forgiveness for that offense, or they have not forgiven somebody else for that offense. So what ends up transpiring is that offense becomes a root of bitterness in their heart. So they stop talking to people for years and years and years. Bitterness, offense. They have been bitten by the viper of resentment, bitterness, and offense. Especially us as the teachers and preachers of this word, we must make sure that we don't fall into being offended and resentful of the people whenever they are not receptive of the truth we speak to them. So many brothers and sisters I see, they get resentful and bitter because people aren't receiving the truth that they're telling them. Brothers and sisters, wipe the dust off. Don't let that viper bite you, that viper of offense and bitterness and resentment. Because what it will do is cause your ministry or to cause your witness to be tainted, because now you're starting to preach to people out of bitterness and resentment. You get in your feelings that nobody's listening or nobody's taking action on the things you're telling them. Don't let that happen. I've even almost been a victim of that. But we can't let that viper of resentment, bitterness, and offense get to us. We must continue to do the work of the Most High, whether they listen or don't listen. Hallelujah. Now, here's another thing we can learn about the spirit of the viper and how it works through actual physical people. Let's go to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, starting at verse 10, also called the book of Sirach. Listen to what it says here. Sirach, chapter 12, verse 10. Never trust your enemy, for his wickedness is like bronze that rusts. Even if he acts humbly and goes about bent over, look out for yourself and be on your guard against him. You must be to him like a man who wipes a mirror clean, and you must make sure that it is not all covered with rust. Do not place him at your side, or he may overthrow you and take your place. Do not seat him at your right hand, or he may try to get your seat, and you may at last learn the truth of what I say and be stung by my words. Listen to verse 13. Who pities a snake charmer when he is bitten, or all those who have to do with wild animals? In the same way, who will pity a man who approaches a sinner and mingles with his sins? He will stay with you for a while, but if you will fall, he will not hold out. And an enemy will speak sweetly with his lips, but in his heart, he will plan to throw you into a pit. Listen to that. This is why I can't feel sorry for some of these Negroes that they end up marrying a white person, especially some of these sisters, end up marrying a white boy, and the white boy ends up killing them. All right? That's why I can't feel sorry for these Negroes that try to hang with all these white folks, going to sleepovers with them, dating all these white folks all over to their house, all around their kids, then something end up happening to them. Well, why were you around your natural bloodline enemy? Why are you around all these other Gentiles? Then you get surprised when they turn on you. That's like you trying to be a snake charmer, then get shocked when you get bit. Like them dumb Christians that be handling them snakes, taking up them serpents, dancing around with the snakes, talking about the Most High told me to dance around with this snake. Then they end up getting bit and die. Who can feel sorry for them? So the scripture there is saying you don't need to be out here hanging around with your enemies. Like the sister right there in Cumming, Georgia, right up the road from where I live at, went to a sleepover with all these white ladies. She ends up getting her head bashed in and tossed over the rail. Well, why was you over there with a bunch of white folks? You know these people are your natural bloodline enemies. Why do you want to be all around them, hanging around them? It's one thing to do business with them. I don't even be having no white folks in my house. I just do business with them. The ones I do business with, the most I'll do is meet up somewhere, go out to eat, and do business with them. But I don't even be having white folks and Gentiles and all that all over to my house. I don't want to be close to them like that. You know why? I don't want to get close to no viper. And I have to vet the Negroes I have around me too. But I vet the Gentiles even more. I keep them at more of a distance. But Negroes, I vet them too. You know why? Because I don't want to get bit by the viper. I don't trust my enemies. I don't trust a snake. Because the prophecy that was given in the Garden of Eden from the beginning is that the serpent would bite the heel. But we must be a people who crush the head of the serpent. We must crush the viper. And we must establish that battlement over our spiritual house by never trusting our enemies. That's how we establish a battlement. Hallelujah. Now, let's talk about the next spirit, which is the lurker. The lurker. You know how the scripture says the enemy goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. You know there's a lot of people who are lurkers, meaning they're nosy, they're watching you, they're observing you. They are lurkers, right? Now, let's go to Ecclesiasticus chapter 11, starting at verse 29. Listen to this. It exposes the spirit of the lurker. People who are constantly lurking, trying to catch you off guard. They lurk your social media pages. They lurk your videos. They don't make themselves known. They just sit back in the cut lurking, waiting for a moment where they can strike you. Curses be upon all you lurkers out there. Here's what it says. Do not bring any and every man to your home, for a treacherous man has many wiles. A proud man's heart is like a decoy partridge in a cage, and like a spy, he looks for your downfall. Stop. So we got Negroes out here that are lurkers and spies. Some of them are actually agents of the government, and they lurk and spy on you to look for your downfall. Listen to this. For he tries to entrap you, turning good into evil, and he finds fault with your favorite things. A spark of fire kindles a whole heap of coals, and a sinful man lies in wait for blood. Beware of an evildoer, for he contrives wickedness, or he will bring blame on you forever. So the scripture there is telling us the way that we set up a spiritual battlement is not to let any and everybody into our home. I know the scripture says for us to entertain strangers, but it don't tell you you have to entertain every stranger that comes along. So we must be wise and beware that there are people who are lurkers. They want to get into your house to see what you got, to try to ambush you, to rob you. They want to get up in your house to, you know, get next to your husband or your wife to try to take them. Some of them may be pedophiles trying to lurk and get around and, you know, see your schedule to find out when they can try to snatch your child. Most High forbid. These lurker spirits are out here, and these people lurk and watch and spy. This is why my wife all the time, whenever she's coming home, if she sees somebody trailing her, she'll take a different route until she don't see that person behind. You see, little things like that you can do to block yourself off from these lurkers. If you got social media, you can put your account on private mode. See, you don't have to answer every text. You don't have to answer every email. Somebody, because people can send you emails with a virus in it, or send you an email just to be nosy and get in your business. Sending all these emails asking you all these questions when really they're just trying to lurk and get in your business. So the scripture is telling us we must be wise against spirits like that, these lurkers, these nosy folks. Listen to what it says in Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1. If you do a kindness, know to whom you are doing it, and you will be thanked for your good deeds. If you do a kindness to a godly man, you will be repaid, if not by him, yet by the Most High. The man who persists in evil will not prosper, nor the man who will not give to charity. Give to the godly man and do not help the sinner. You see, the scripture is giving us this wisdom because some people will come to you saying they need help, only to set that as a trap to try to ambush you. Like I've heard from other brothers about how there will be some sisters that come to them talking about, you know, Ak, I need help, or can you teach me? Can you show me some stuff in scripture? And the brother ends up out of the kindness of his heart trying to teach this person and share with them things. And later on, the person tries to use those text messages, or they record a phone call, they screenshot conversations. And later on, they try to expose that person saying, look, brother so-and-so was trying to holler at me. Brother so-and-so was, you know, trying to come on to me. When really the brother was just trying to help the sister with scriptures. But they'll screenshot the conversations, they'll record the conversations, they'll screenshot all the text and then use it later to try to say, look at this person. They not who they claim to be. So they'll lurk to try to get close to you. This is why you must be wise, brothers and sisters, about who you have phone conversations with, what you say in those phone conversations, who you text, and what you say in those texts. Because Negroes are lurkers these days. And that spirit of the lurker will try to set you up with screenshots, recorded phone calls, and make you look bad in front of everybody else. You see? That's why the scripture says you don't have to help everybody that comes to you, because some people are coming as a lurker. Some people are just around you to lurk and see if they can find something wrong with you and then go tell everybody else about it. You see? It's real out here. So that's another spirit. Let's talk about another type of entity, the spire, S-P-I-R-E. You know what a spire is? It's a high place. Like on a lot of these churches, at the very top, they got the steeple with the pagan cross symbol. That's a spire. A spire is a high place, all right? And what does the scripture tell us about high places? Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So you know what a spire is? A spire is a spirit that is trying to overpower you. You know, like whenever Nimrod was building the tower, in the household, sometimes you have people that they always have to get the last word. They always have to have the upper hand. That could be a spire spirit. Somebody that is always trying to have the high place. They're always trying to be above somebody else. They talk down to people. They always acting like everybody else is so beneath them. That's the spirit of a spire. That's the spirit of high places, right? Let's go through some scriptures about this. This is why the Father tells us to build a battlement on the roof, because the roof is the highest place of the house. So by building a battlement on the roof, you're not allowing the enemy to put a spire on your roof, or to build a high place on your roof, or to put a nest of demons on your roof. Your battlement will be blocking the spire of the enemy. You see? Numbers 22:41, it says, "And it came to pass on the morrow that Balak took Balaam and brought him up into the high places of Baal." So Baal and all these other false gods, they build these high places, because that is a spirit that is operating through those high places. 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 9. "And the children of Israel did secretly those things that were not right against the Most High, their Elohim. And they built them high places in all their cities, from the tower of the watchmen to the fenced city." So there in 2 Kings, it was saying that in the towers of the watchmen, they were building high places. So the place where there was supposed to be a watchman who was watching over the city to defend it, instead, they built high places and altars of demons. So that's exactly what will happen to us if we are not having a battlement on our spiritual roof. It will be replaced by a demonic altar. Are you seeing this? This is what takes place in the spiritual realm. Now, let's go to Proverbs chapter 9, verse 13 and 14. It says, "A foolish woman is clamorous. She is simple and knoweth nothing. For she sitteth at the door of her house on a seat in the high places of the city." So the scripture here says that a whorish woman, a foolish woman, is always trying to set herself in the high place to get attention. So a lot of these Instagram hoes, a lot of these half-dressed women, a lot of these whorish women, they are under the influence of the spirit of the spire because they want attention. They set themselves in the highest place. They talk all loud whenever they're out in public, dressing all hoish out in public, because what they want to do, they want to set themselves at the high place. They want attention. They're setting themselves at the high place to get that attention. That is the spirit of a spire. Even when Jezebel was reigning, she would always be on the top of the house, the roof. That's why she died by getting tossed over the roof. Whenever Jehu came to kill her, the eunuchs tossed her off the roof. So we, as the men of the Most High, we must toss down these Jezebel spirits that seek to put themselves on top, when it's the man's job to be on top and to lead. You see? So we must not fall victim to these attention whores and these spirits that set themselves in high places just because they want to be seen, clout chasing, doing things for views and hits, doing things to be seen. Are you starting to realize this? That is the spirit of a spire. So we must be like those righteous kings who tore down the high places. All the righteous kings like Josiah, Hezekiah, Jehu, the Father loved them because they did what? They tore down the high places. They tore down the spires and the high idols. They tore them down by speaking truth to power. We must never let a spire rise higher than the battlement that we have over our households. And then the last spirit, the conspirator. The conspirator. We indeed know that we live in times where there are a lot of conspiracies. There's a lot that goes on behind the scenes that affects what takes place in the world. And all that is the work of the spirit of the conspirator, those who have taken crafty counsel. So in order for us to set up a battlement over our house, we must pray curses on those who are taking secret, crafty counsel against us, whether it be governments, presidents, or whether it be some of our own cousins or family members. We must pray that the Most High would expose those who are conspiring against us, those who are plotting against us. Just like Esther and Mordecai was able to know that Haman was plotting on them. We as the people of the Most High must stand watch on the battlement of our house to go to war against the conspirators. Let's go to Luke 20:20. This is an interesting verse because the year 2020 is coming up and there's going to be a lot of conspirators, and the spirit of the conspirator is going to be working heavy in the 2020s. So let's go to Luke 20:20. It says, "And they watched him and sent forth spies, which should feign themselves just men, that they might take hold of his words, that they might deliver him unto the power and authority of the governor." So in the time of the Messiah, The government sent conspirators amongst him to catch him in his words. And we live in a time where they have a lot of surveillance equipment. These are the times where the Messiah told us, be wary as serpents, harmless as doves. The reason he said that is because he knew we would be surrounded by conspirators. People's own husbands and wives will be delivering them up to be killed. That's a conspirator spirit. So we must always be standing on the battlement of our roof so that we can discern the agents and the conspirators, so that we can know who is targeting us. There indeed is a such thing as people who are targeted, and that is the spirit of the conspirator. But guess what? You can go to war against the conspirator. You can target those who target you. You can pray curses and arrows of fire against those who are targeting you. We must go on the offensive in these times. Don't sit there like a victim crying like, man, I'm a targeted individual. Well, guess what? You can target them just like they target you. You are a warrior just like they are warriors. You are a hunter just like they are hunters. So it's time for you to get out of victim mode and hunt those who hunt you. Target those who target you. Go to war against the spirit of the conspirator. Let's go to Acts chapter 23, verse 12 through 13. It says, and when it was day, certain of the Jews banded together and bound themselves under a curse, saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. And they were more than 40, which had made this conspiracy. So even in the days of Paul, there were people who were conspiring against him. And they even swore themselves under a curse that they would not eat or drink until they had killed Paul. Don't you know there's people out here right now who are doing the same thing with us? That they have swore an oath that they will be at war against us. There's no way that you can trust somebody with a spirit like that. So you must stand on your battlement and go to war and curse those that send those curses at you. You must go to war against the conspirator who is trying to secretly take crafty counsel against you. So before I go, let me go through this list of spirits again that we must stand and fight against: the corrupter, the disruptor, the assimilator, the interceptor, the viper, the lurker, the spire, and the conspirator. We must get victory over all these spirits. Hallelujah. All praise to the Most High. I pray that you've got something from that. Before I go, I want to make brothers and sisters aware of some projects of the ministry that we've released that will definitely be great for you to get in your hands. We have released the 613 Laws of Torah audiobook. This is a 5-hour long audiobook that's narrated by myself. It contains all 613 laws and commands of Torah. This audiobook is narrated from the King James Version. I don't use any pagan names like God or Lord. And I give you the chapter and verse where each law is found. So as you're listening, you can study for yourself the laws and commands. We put together this audio book because the scripture says that faith comes by hearing. The scripture also commands us in Joshua chapter 1, verse 6 through 8, that we are commanded to meditate on the laws and commands day and night. And we live in a time with a lot of technology. So we put the laws and commands in audio book form so that you can listen to the laws and commands. You can download the audio book. You can listen to the laws and commands while you're riding in your car, while you're at work, while you're working out, while you're cooking in the kitchen, while you're going to sleep at night, while you're cleaning up the house, while you're studying scripture. You can have the laws and commands of this audiobook playing in your headphones or playing out loud. So once again, it is a 5-hour audiobook narrated by myself. It is the 613 Laws of Torah. This project has impacted a lot of people greatly. So to the point where we hit number one on Amazon in the genre of Hebrew Bible and meditation. Also, many people's heart has been turned back to the laws and commands by investing in this project. It is a powerful audio book. I will put the link in the description box underneath this video on how you can invest in that project. It is the 613 Laws of Torah audio book narrated by myself, Brother L. So just check out the link in the description box underneath this video to find out how to invest in that great, great project. Another project that we have done is the Words of the Messiah audiobook. This is a 4-hour long audiobook, also narrated by myself, and it covers the parables and wise sayings of the Messiah recorded in scripture from Matthew to John, all of his wise sayings and parables. We put together this audiobook because the scripture says that the Messiah is the Word made flesh. He lived in such a way where he never broke his Father's law. So whenever you meditate on his words, it teaches you how to worship the Most High in spirit and in truth. It teaches you how to walk in the same footsteps as the Messiah. So we put together that audiobook. It's 4 hours long with all the words of the Messiah. And it is also narrated from the King James Version. I will put the link in the description box underneath this video to show you how you can invest in that project, the Words of the Messiah audiobook. Once again, it's a 4-hour long audiobook, also narrated by myself. We have another amazing project called the Words of the Father audiobook. This is a 14-hour long audiobook, also narrated by myself. This audiobook contains all the words out of the Most High's own mouth that he spoke himself or through the inspiration of the prophets. And once again, it's narrated from the King James Version, and we don't use any pagan names. All the way from Genesis, where the Father said, "Let there be light," all the way to the New Testament, where he says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." We put together this audiobook because the scripture says that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Father. So we put together an audiobook with only the words of the Father, 14 hours long, narrated from the King James, narrated by myself. I will also put the link in the description box under this video on how you can invest in that project. Another project we're doing right now is the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus campaign. The scripture says that we are commanded to bring this truth to all four corners of the earth because our people have been dispersed to all four corners of the earth. So through the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus movement, we are traveling from city to city all over the United States and all over the world. And whenever we go to these cities, we will be preaching and teaching, baptizing. We will be visiting the homeless shelters, the orphanages, the prisons, the jails, the nursing homes to minister to our people. And whenever we go to these cities, we will also be having meetings with brothers and sisters to discuss launching home fellowships, launching home businesses, and doing homeschooling. These are the things that we will be doing. We will also be acquiring land. Here in January of 2020, we will be acquiring land in Georgia and in Arkansas. And this will be the beginning of Torah-based communities and Hebrew farms so that we can grow our own food, herd our own cattle, and be self-sustained and truly be set apart from our adversaries. So that's what the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus campaign is all about. For those that are interested in traveling with us and supporting us, you'll see my email in the description box underneath this video. For those who are interested in supporting with donations and monetary donations, I will put the link in the description box for the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus GoFundMe. I will also put the Cash App for the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus for those who are interested in investing in this project. A lot of great things are going on. I'm excited about what the Father has done and will do. We've been traveling to San Diego, Jamestown. Here coming up soon, we're going to be traveling to New York, D.C., Ohio, many places. And that's what the Hebrews for Excellence and Exodus is all about. So check out all the links in the description box for what the ministry has going on. But for now, I'm going to say shalom until we speak again. Hallelujah.
That was excellent. I love his throwback videos. They are so good. But he did obtain land. In fact, the last time Brother L came on with us live stream, he came live and fellowshiped with us. Many of you may remember that. That was around the time he obtained land. So he already have land. Thank you, Mr. Lawrence, for the super sticker. Thank you so much, everybody. And look, demons are going to be rampant around us. We're in the home stretch of this walk. You know, the 400 years is up. And right now, a lot of things are in derision. So it is up to us to recognize when those demons are around us and do our best to cast them away. You know, so if you have to go back and listen to this again, a lot of times I listen to Brother L sometimes 2 or 3 times. You know, I don't just stop listening to any of his audio just on the Sabbath. Sometimes if it's real interesting like this one, I'll go back and review it again. It doesn't hurt to do it. So everybody, happy Passover for those of you that are celebrating. There's another Passover again at the end of the month. If you happen to miss this one or you were not able to get your lamb for one reason or another, then you can do it again at the end of the month. You only have to do it once. So if you don't do it now, then at the end of the month, that's the second Passover, you should do it. So everybody, wherever you are, please enjoy the rest of this holy holiday. And, you know, if you are doing the week of unleavened bread, which follows Passover, make sure you get all of that unleavened bread out of your home. Okay. And on that note, everybody, Shabbat Shalom. Thank you.